Everybody get up.
No more pretending, 'cause now you're winning. Here's our beginning.
lose it. This new Snoop, come on, baby boo, you got to get into it. Grown fool with the player with the cool wit. Yeah, yeah, you know I'm always on that cool. Walk to it, do it how you do it. Have a glass, let me put you in the mood. It, little cupid, looking like a student. Long hair with your big fat booty. Back in the days, you was the girl I went to school with. Had to tell your mom or sister to cool it. The girl wanna do it, I just might do it. Get her off with some pimp fluid. Mommy, don't worry, I won't abuse it. Hurry up and finish so you can watch Clueless. I laugh at these kids when they ask who do this, but everybody know who girl that you is.
Beautiful.
Right, hope y'all are doing great today. We're gonna be finishing up Performance Tumen, and we're gonna be talking about some other things. Let's get on forward to where we need to be with Performance Tuning. Let's see, we got to right about here, I believe. Yeah, right at the video. All right, so just as a quick reminder, we're gonna do this quick video, and then we're gonna start talking about Performance Tuning. So check it out. This is a video that will explain threading and a little bit about performance to you. Here you go.
Ah, threading. So powerful that you can fold genomes with it, but so difficult that it can drive the average programmer insane. My name is Colt McCandless, and as far as Android development is concerned, threading is one of the most important and most confusing things that you can deal with. Which means if you want to write the fastest app possible, you've got to take a minute and understand the subtle art that is multi-threaded programming. Remember that in the vast world of Android functions, there's a whole boatload of operations that only execute on the main thread. System events, input events, application callbacks, services, and even alarms. And for the most part, any code that you write executes inside one of these operations, which means it also runs on the main thread. Now, if you recall, work that executes on the main thread gets there after being pulled from the front of a work queue. So blocks of work are done in order, and the next block of work isn't processed until the current one is completed, which means if there's a large chunk of work between an input event and its callback, then the user will have to wait longer than expected to see results. And don't forget that the main thread is also where most of the screen rendering occurs. While an animation or screen update is occurring, the system will try to draw the screen every 16 milliseconds or so to achieve smooth 60 frames per second. The problem is that this is happening while the thread is also responding to app input events. So if your app is in the middle of an animation and some random work packet takes longer than expected, you'll miss your chance to render that next frame within the 16 millisecond window, and that frame will be delayed. This is what we call a dropped frame, and when this happens, users start to notice. The direct solution here is to move anything that might upset the 16 millisecond window over somewhere else, like to a different thread. This way, it won't be contesting with the UI thread for work to be done and won't be interrupting the drawing of the screen, which is the whole point of threading on Android in a nutshell. So the question at hand, what's the best way to offload this work, and how do you choose what types of work to offload? Thankfully, the Android framework has provided a handful of classes to help make this a bit easier for you.
All right, we're gonna stop it there because that was just supposed to be a quick reminder. Remember that one of the main things about performance that y'all will need to know for this class is, hey, we don't want to do things on the UI thread that we should do elsewhere, because then it's going to look like our app is broken, and that's going to be a problem. Users are going to start to notice. Okay, so there's all kinds of constructs in Android, basically API, that you can use. There's all kinds of constructs that you can use in Android to help, but it all boils down to this, okay? If you are doing work in the UI thread that is anything other than super trivial, you shouldn't be doing it there, okay? You should have that work started from the UI thread, like, hey, go start a thread somewhere else, have the work done somewhere else on a different thread. And then later on, when you need to update your UI, like when that thing is done, then that can happen in the UI thread, and that's fine. I'm just making sure that you guys aren't trying to talk to me. Okay. So there are some constructs in Android. We're not going to go over them specifically too much. But for instance, doing background is a good thing for you to know about because, hey, that's an easy way. ASIC test, doing background, easy way for you to push some work from your thread, which is, maybe perhaps the UI thread, to a background thread. So you know it's not going to screw with your UI responsiveness. All right, so there is that. For instance, here is a good example of how you might use such a construct. Here is the async test. For instance, if you have a click, where would it what would trigger on click in your app? What might trigger on click? Let me know in the chat. How would an on click method ever be triggered from your app? Like what UI element might have an on click and how would it be triggered by somebody? Let me know in the chat. I can wait here all day. No problem if y'all want to just hang out. Yeah, pressing a button. Someone clicking a button. That's almost certainly the most common way that on clicks are going to happen, right? So somebody presses a button. You can see that this download image task dot execute is being called. Okay, this is the async task which runs in the background. Okay, so you can see that we start things from here, but they happen in this async task right here, and that's good. So again, this is kind of what we're supposed to be doing. We want to push things from our UI thread. Well, let me ask something. Is this on click? What thread is on click being executed in? Who can tell me where is on click being executed? Where is that? What thread is on click being executed? And this is an answerable question. What thread is on click being executed on? Main thread or UI thread? I would call it, I personally call it the UI thread. Although main thread is also basically correct. And that's anything that's have any handler that is triggered from your UI will be running on the UI thread. On clicks, on press, I mean, whatever you can else you can think of, that will be in the UI thread. So anything that happens there, you don't want to put your actual code there. You want to start a task from there. All right, let's think, that's what you're supposed to do, okay? Push things from the UI thread to elsewhere. Now let's take a look at what we maybe don't want to do. All right, so here's a scenario. I take 100 HD videos of my children on my mobile phone and uploading them to my computer is slow. So to improve the data transfer rate from my phone to the computer, I want to parallelize the current program. However, the ability to sync my device over Wi-Fi when it's idle may be what I need to improve. Okay, so let me explain this a little bit better. If I have a bunch of like pictures on my phone, there's two ways that you might consider making this transfer. Excuse me, making this transfer like faster. You may say, hey, we want to do all these transfers in parallel. So we want to start a ton of threads immediately, like 100 threads even, immediately and just go to town, use all that cores. However, like that's not really how the user would look at it right now. What happens in real photo apps is I want to have something that says start uploading and then, just upload in the background forever. Like, don't screw with my performance on all my other apps, but just go to the background and slowly upload these photos. I don't need them like now. So the performance that we want here is not 100 threads all uploading photos, which may even be bound or slowed down by your Wi-Fi connection. What you want is something that you can press and it goes off into the background forever and just does it. Okay, so not all performance issues are about getting it done super fast or getting it done now. They're more about getting it done in a way that meets the user constraints, but does not get in the way of the user. So uploading them slowly in the background doesn't mess with my phone performance, but it still gets the job done like overnight while I'm asleep. So that's good. So there are several different ways to improve performance without doing a lot with code. For instance, if you have a good architecture, if you have a good architecture, that will generally improve your code performance. If you have an OS that isn't great, your OS may be causing some problems. And you may look to replace the OS, but that's obviously like a pretty extreme step. Compilers actually help you improve your code. And of course, hardware itself can just be upgraded, right? Sometimes you need to just get better hardware. I've noticed when working with students that you guys often have not good hardware for computer scientists, and I'm not trying to hassle you. I know that buying new hardware, especially more than once in your college career, is a real pain and very expensive. But like, if you're going to be a developer, you definitely need to have a certain level of hardware. And you know, one way to make Android Studio run faster is obviously just to get a better computer. One tip. Yeah, sorry, I'm not trying to hassle you guys about being poor. I was a poor student at one time too. I only had one computer for all 4 years. However, I do want to point out that if you get a desktop instead of a laptop, you can definitely get a you can get a cheaper but better machine. Also, somebody's pointing out in the chat, computer labs generally have hardware that is definitely good enough to run things like Android Studio performantly. Something to keep in mind if Android Studio is really getting your computer down. You can even, I believe you can VPN into those. All right, anyway. One thing that really comes, like happens in performance optimization is that you get most of the, you know, the Pareto principle happens or occurs, and you get a ton of results from, you know, a small amount of effort or 20% of your effort. And here's what is meant by this. There's basically almost certainly in most people's code, there's like, certain methods that are called more than all the rest of the code. And so if you put your time into optimizing just these methods, then you will have much better outcomes. Okay, so let's say you have a huge application, but there's one core thing that it does focus on optimizing that part and not the other things. All right. One thing that is a key principle when you're going to start doing optimization is to measure or profile your code first. Who can tell me what I mean by profiling? Who can tell me what I mean by profiling? In the chat, let me know what I mean by profiling. And everybody buy better computers. Let me know in the chat, what do I mean by profiling? Okay, I'm getting some good answers. Thank you, guys and gals. Yeah, so some great answers. Thank you. What I mean by profiling is in most languages and in most IDEs, there is a way to run your code kind of like debugging your code. But instead of debugging where you can hit breakpoints and things like that, it will record exactly how long all of the different methods within your code take to run. Okay? So it basically instruments your code, and then it can provide you with a report about like, hey, these methods are the ones that are taking the most time. Actually, I don't know if Android Studio has a nice one built in, but you can always get trials on professional ones. This is not something you need to run like all the time. However, this is something you need to run probably like once a semester, or you'll have like a special sprint for performance or something like that. So it tells you kind of where you're losing time. Somebody's saying Android Studio does have a nice profiler, and you should consider using it at least once in the semester per team in order to make sure your app is performant. All right, so just a few things to keep in mind as you think about performance. Reducing the lines of code actually doesn't improve performance. Lines of code and performance are not very correlated, right? So just wanted you to know that. And the interesting thing, number two here, assume that certain operations are probably faster or smaller than others. You really will have a hard time guessing what operations are faster and slower than others. For instance, there is a very, has anybody ever read the book Java Elements? There's a pretty well-known example from Java Elements where the author does a little bit of math and he actually does it with integers, like capital I integers, and he does what you would call like boxing and unboxing, meaning, just casting numbers from little int to big integer, and things like that. And in this experiment, he shows that this casting or unboxing of like a primitive to an object is that super expensive and slows down the code immensely, way more than you would ever think for something so simple. So all that to say that things that may you think may be trivial are not trivial. For instance, I remember programming in PHP back in the day, and if you use double quotes, like normal quotes that you would use to concatenate strings, that operation is really expensive because you can have things like regexes and all that kind of stuff in there, and it's got to analyze it. But if you use single quotes, just the tick marks, it takes your string as a literal, and that operation is super fast. And there's a huge difference between the two. So anyway, there's little details that really affect performance. I feel like I'm getting behind here. Speaking of performance. All right. Another pitfall is you should never optimize as you go. We don't want to over-optimize our code. We want our code to be readable, and that is the most important thing, readable code that other people can understand. Optimization comes second, and it mainly comes when you realize, hey, user's having a bad experience. Things that commonly cause problems, input and output, or writing to disk a lot, that can definitely cause a lot of problems. And cache misses, again, related to input and output, can also cause a lot of problems. In fact, if you start really thinking at a low level about cache missing, you'll notice things like this, where one of these versions of the code is much less performant than the other because of missing of cache hits. So I leave that as the exercise to you to figure out which one is better than the other. That will not be on the quiz or on the test or anything, but I just want you to know that these low-level concerns can really change the performance of your code. All right. Other things that could be very expensive, system calls can be very expensive. And this is the one that I was just talking about, like PHP or Python, where you have some interpreting of the code, meaning basically compilation of the code happening when it is actually executed, that can really slow things down. Okay. Somebody wants me to go back, so I will to here. Where do you want me to go back? You want me to go back one more, I think, right? All right, I just want to reiterate this, it's not very important which one is better or worse. What is important here is that the low-level concerns of the code cause some major differences in performance, even though this code looks like it should be basically the same. And what is happening here is that one of the versions of these codes causes major cache missing, meaning like you're reading from memory and you have all these cache misses, and then that, of course, very much degrades performance. And the other version of the code does not. And I'm not going to tell you which is which. I leave that as exercise to you. But again, that is a very low-level concern that we're not trying to learn in this class. It's just the idea that low-level concerns can really cause a difference in your code's performance. So just to summarize, what y'all want to do is you want to develop code that is first and foremost well-designed and easy to read and easy for other humans to deal with. That is absolutely the most important thing to do. If people, like users of your app, start to notice the performance is poor, or you during testing notice the performance is poor, you want to start doing things like profiling it and figuring out where the problems are and tune the code and repeat. Okay? What is the one other thing that you definitely want to do kind of during initial code development to make sure that your code is performant? The thing that we have watched videos on and talked about quite a bit, what is the one thing that you want to do while developing your phone apps that is important? And you're going to do this during initial development. Let me know in the chat, what do you think is the number one thing I'm going to say that is very important? No, that's you're right in general for this class. But what I'm saying regarding performance, what is one thing that you will do when you're creating your app that will be very important in terms of its performance? And especially the user's perception of its performance. Yes. All right. Now we're starting to get it stay off the UI thread, the main thread. When we're creating our app, we want to make sure that all major work is not done on the main thread, or else when that user presses that button, it will look like your app has crashed because it'll go do a ton of work on the main thread and it won't be responsive. So stay the heck off the main thread. That is a big point. Somebody's asking, I'm confused about the concept of the main thread. That's one of the reasons I talk about it so much, is because it is confusing. All right, so there's one thread that is responsible for drawing, meaning like physically drawing on the screen your UI. Okay. If that thread is busy doing something else, let's say it's busy calculating your taxes or whatever the heck your app is doing, and it takes a ton, it takes like 10 seconds to calculate your taxes. Okay. You press a button. Now you're in the UI thread. You're still in the UI thread. You go calculate taxes for 10 seconds. Guess what? Your entire UI will be frozen for 10 seconds and it will look like it has crashed. Okay. So you only want to do UI related things in the UI thread. If you press that button and it spins off another thread and it does whatever the heck it wants to, then the UI will continue to be redrawn and it'll be responsive. So do the work in another thread, if that helps. Some other things that you're going to need to keep in mind in Android is battery is going to be another important thing. If you're doing a ton of background work, like all the time, you're going to start to hit the battery a lot, and people get very angry if you kill their battery. So that is something additionally that you will need to do, keep in mind with Android. And all right, so don't ask me anything right now because we are going to move on to today's lecture, which is all about code reviews. Yeah, and so people are saying right in the chat, great points, which is it sounds like you are learning exactly what you need to right now. If you're wondering why your app is kind of like skipping or being frozen, that's because you're doing stuff in the UI thread that is causing, yes, that is causing like your UI thread to be not drawing. It's doing work instead of drawing. Okay, you want your UI thread to be drawing, like you say in the chat. You want to change the work that's happening to run in some other thread. Great. I feel like y'all are learning today. That's awesome. All right, code reviews is what we're talking about today. But first, we have a few more announcements I want to get to, and we got to start moving. Sorry, we're going to go a little fast today. Next assignment is out. Y'all know that it is due not this Friday, which is today, but next Friday. Okay? It is all about creating a 1 minute or less demo video of your app. And to help facilitate that, we will be having what is known as a work week next week. That is a week in which you need to focus on committing to your project as well as making your video. Remember, if you want to work on your video and you want to still be committing, you can also commit things like clips of your project, images that you might use. You can commit all those things into a special folder on your project so that I know you're still working on your project, okay? So even if you're spending a lot of time on the video, which would be fine, make sure you're committing. Next week is a work week. And by work week, I mean we will have no lectures next week. Next week is absolutely your time to have these 3 hours off. So I expect at least 3 hours of work next week, hopefully a bit more, where you can focus on making commits and making this video as a group. And in case you haven't got it, I want you next week to make commits. Even if you're just making the video, commit those artifacts to your repository so I know that you're working and have worked on your project. Okay. Somebody's asking. Commenting, what I'm hearing is you're taking a vacation next week. Actually, so next week I will be still around in town, and if y'all need have any questions or anything, but I am running the International Conference on Fundamentals of Software Engineering along with a bunch of software engineering researchers. So I will be doing that. If you want to see some of those research talks, so let me know. I can maybe post the Zoom link in our Slack, but yeah, they're pretty advanced, like research and software engineering. All right, so today we're gonna be talking about code reviews, and so that's what we're gonna be talking about today. All right, so as you guys and gals know, writing bug-free code is impossible. Developers are inserting an average of 1 to 3 defects per hour into their design and 5 to 8 defects per hour into code. Now, take a minute to think about your own code. Do you think that that's true? Is your app working perfectly? I bet I can crash any of y'all's app within probably 5 minutes of getting it in my hands, and we might even try to do that later on in the semester where we have a contest. How long does it take for a professor to crash your app? I can almost guarantee that I can crash everybody's app, especially their first version, within about 30 seconds. All right. Now, what is a code review? Code review is just where you've implemented something, and maybe it's a bigger feature or it's a more complicated feature. You spend some time letting somebody else look at it before you really commit it, to the repository or to the final repository. Interesting thing about these code reviews is they do help improve code quality. They definitely help you communicate with your teammates and understand how they're writing code and learn from them. And they improve each other's implementation skills because you learn stuff from them and they learn stuff from you. This is an idea that's been around forever, like since the 70s, but it has slowly become a more and more accepted practice. And in fact, like at Google, I know, and Google and Microsoft, they have a lot of tooling around these now to help people do code reviews. Some people have done like a lot of academic study on code reviews, and you have to take these academic studies with a grain of salt because there's been a lot of study of them and not all the information is really in agreement yet. But some people have said that you can find, you know, almost as many or maybe even more errors than testing with code reviews. But perhaps one of the best things about a code review is that if you know you're going to have to do a code review with somebody, especially somebody that you respect, then you don't want to show them embarrassingly bad code. So often people put a lot more work into their code and they scrutinize it more before they check it in. That, in my opinion, is one of the best benefits of code reviews. All right, so there's kind of two types of code reviews. There's like the very formal type, which has different roles and it's almost like a role-playing game. And then there's the informal type, which is just walking through your code or doing some pair programming. And both types can be very effective, however. Formal code reviews, as I mentioned, they have these distinct roles like a moderator, author, reviewers, and a scribe to write down what's happening. And you can see, like, for instance, reviewers have to look through the code before the meeting and arrive with a set of comments. They have focused effort where they're looking for certain types of errors, detailed comments on certain mistakes, and then usually have a special meeting afterwards to make sure that all the changes were implemented. Informal code reviews, which I think are perhaps even more beneficial. These are where you kind of just get with a colleague that you respect. You do prepare for the review in terms of you trying to write the best code you can. They try and look over your code before you come, and then you go through the code and figure out things that need to be fixed and make notes so that you can fix them later. Somebody's asking, are code reviews usually team-wide or just with another team member or two? Yeah, code reviews are usually just 1 to 4 people, so not necessarily the whole team. I would say the average number of people is 3, and so they're kind of smaller events. Interesting thing about informal code reviews like this is they can almost be seen as mentoring, where, you know, you get your code ready, you give it to a mentor or somebody that has more experience with you, they give you lots of feedback and you improve your code. And in my opinion, that's one of the best ways to do code reviews, as see it as almost like a mentoring process. Pair programming is more of with a equal, you know, two people are, well, first of all, how many people have ever heard of pair programming? Let me know in the chat. Have you ever heard of pair programming before this lecture? Let me know in the chat so I can move on. At least one person has. Interesting that VCU does it in 255 and 256. That's cool. I did not know that. As you guys and gals know, I'm kind of new here. But yeah, it is, you know, helpful. You have the driver and the observer. It's very helpful for getting better and learning from each other, and that's why you do it in 255 and 256. As you know, it can also be maddening because, you know, you, when you're at the computer, you have to explain verbally what to do to the other person sometimes, and that is really infuriating. So I personally am not all about the pair programming. I understand it's a great tool while you're learning. So during school, I think it's a great tool. After school, I would encourage more like this mentoring and code review kind of approach. Okay. Now, I would like to do a 10-second code review. Who is brave enough to let me pull their code up on the screen? Just like one class or method. from your code, hit me up in the chat, send me a repository so that we can look at your code right here in the screen. My username is David C. Shepherd. I'll put that in the chat as well. Who wants to have just a couple seconds of code review done on their code? Put your URL for your repository. All right, I'm already on some people's repository. Let's see if I can find their repository. All right, so how about this? Since I did it with Williams last week, all right, how do I pronounce your name properly? Fyodor? Fyodor? Please let me know how to pronounce that properly. But anyway, do you want to send me yours? Fedya. Is Fedya more correct? This is where I really miss being in class, because you could tell me. So, Fedya. Theodore. Interesting. That's an awesome name. But can you send me or invite me to your repository? Do you already have? And I will go ahead and look at yours really quick. So he's gonna give me that, and then we're gonna look at code just really quick and see what's up. Note that you can even do reviews here. I haven't explored that tooling, but you can do that. Right in GitHub. All right, and Theodore, can you tell me when you have sent that? Okay, you have sent that. Let me check my email real quick. And list there. Can you send me the URL of your repository as well? I can just use that. So could you also send me the URL of your project real quick? Just put it right there in the chat. Or in Slack. Done. Go. Got it. All right. Let's see if I can get access to this now. All right. So here we have an app. I'm going to start looking at it now. Thank you for sharing. That's awesome. Let's look just at a high level. Here we have the source folder. One of the things that I noticed right here is that's all fine. Everything looks fine. Let's look in main. And here. And here. All right, I'm just taking a quick look around. All right, so it looks like here we have Geocoder and Team in app. I'm going to put you on the spot just a little bit, just a little bit. I'm not going to ask hard questions. So one question that I have right off the bat is about the folder organization. Why is there a geocoder and a team in app? Why are these two separate folders? Why is there a team in app anyway? Like, shouldn't it be in the top level? Should it just be geocoder and then UI and then everything else? What do you guys think? What do you think? Why did you choose this folder structure other than like three different people probably committed different things to different folders. Any comments on that? And other people can also answer at this point whether you think that is a good idea, bad idea. What do you think? Would you have put all of those things in this folder? Yeah, I guess I'm saying like, so that's the question. The question is about folder organization. Geocoder, I'm wondering why isn't it in Team in-app, or why is it called? Yeah, okay, great. So he agrees that maybe Geocoder should be in this Team in-app. Now, another question is why is it called Team in-app? Why and what should it be called? So this is one I open up to everybody. Why, you know, maybe not why is it called Team in-app, but what should you call your app folder? Like what folder would you rather have for here? If I, all right, I'm gonna give you it take I think we have like a few second delay. Somebody's saying maybe we just call it a we call it the nap folder. The idea that I'm trying to bring up here is that naming conventions really matter, okay? Like calling it a Team in app, I have no idea what this app does based on that name, right? So you should never have like code names, or I would never recommend using code names or anything like that. I would always use like a name of the app, okay? So describing what it does. This looks pretty good in general. Like, you know, there's not too many classes here, and then you can see the UI is distinct. I'm not going to go into the details there. And one thing I want to point out here is there's something called second fragment, which again is probably not, I don't know if that's a real thing or not, but sounds like a bad name. Like, let's see if it does anything. It looks like it might do some things, but I'm curious as to why it's called second fragment. Can you explain just a little bit about? Is it called second fragment because it's just old and should be deleted, or do you really have something called second fragment? Anybody got any thoughts on maybe you? Yeah, okay, so people are thinking maybe it should be deleted. You should never have things that are generic, like I can't figure out what it is. Like, for instance, I can tell from settings activity that that is going to have something to do with settings. Now, something else that I see related to naming that is weird is there's something called settings activity two. Why is there both a settings activity and a settings activity two? Okay, so it sounds like settings activity is just a default one, and you have made a settings activity 2 that you actually use. Is that correct? So I just want you to know when you're doing naming, you definitely want to take those seriously. Having one settings activity is good. Having one called settings activity 2 is a little confusing. One thing that may happen is you might have like settings activity, like the main settings activity, but then you might have like detailed settings activity, and that would be okay, right? Because one is more specific than the other, but you never want to have like thing one and thing two. So I do think you're using two different settings activities, maybe, but just let's do the naming a little differently. All right, I'm going to look just a little bit deeper into code, and what I do like, I'm not going to go too deep here because we need to move on, but What I've liked about the code that I've seen is that the classes and the methods are both pretty short, okay? And I feel like I could probably read these and get a good idea of what's happening. Let's look at settings activity 2. Now, this one is getting a little longer, but not too long. The only one that makes me a little nervous is this one right here. It is a little bit long. I would see if maybe, for instance, you might want to take this out so that it's clear what's happening. That's up to you. This is really on the border. But I'm not going to go any deeper than that. I feel like we've... I don't want to go any deeper than that because I feel like y'all have gotten some good ideas on feedback and we do need to do a little bit more lecture. All right, so thank you for sharing your code. Very cool. Makes the class a lot more interesting to do it on real code. The code looks good in general. Just worry about naming and where you put things. That's a very important. All right, that was a little more than 10 seconds. I want you to think about, and I'm kind of curious whether you have done code review or not. Let me know in the chat. Think about what might be the best way and the best time for y'all to do that in this class. Remember, remember that you get credits for commits, okay, in this class. So if you do a code review and then you fix the issues identified in that code review, guess what? You get credit for that work because commits matter, all right? So doing things like a code review is a great way to go ahead and get some more commits in, and you know it still counts for this class. We're gonna have to skip this. One of the things that I wanna talk about very quickly is there has been, again, some study of this, code reviews. For instance, IBM found that each hour of code inspection prevented about 100 hours of related work. The reason that is if you find the bugs now, it saves you a lot of work down the line. Raytheon, again, they reduced their cost of defect correction because they had focused on code inspections, and HP similarly had an inspection program and they think they saved this much per year. All of these are just kind of wild estimates, but I do believe that code review can help save a lot of errors. I think these estimates are hard to believe because it's very hard to measure this kind of thing from a scientific point of view, but the signal is so strong that I do believe these results, and that code review really does save companies and people and projects time. Now, one of the things you need to know about code review is there's a lot of cool tool support, including some support that's built into GitHub. Here, for instance, there's the Garrett Open Code, the Garrett Code Review Platform, which you can check out online. There's many other code review platforms, including internal ones that are used at Microsoft and Google, and Facebook and all the big ones. And that kind of tooling can be very helpful for you to do a code review, but it really is just tooling support that allows you to add little notes in your code and to remember to deal with them and stuff like that. The most important thing is actually doing the code review. Now, to summarize what we've talked about today, code reviews are a useful tool that help improve the quality of the code that you're making, not only the quality of the code that you're making now, like that specific code, but they help you learn, right? Because you might have a more senior person that reviews your code to say, like, maybe you shouldn't do it like this, maybe you should do it like that. And then when you write code in the future, you'll still remember that point. There's two basic types of reviews, formal and informal. Formal has, you know, usually is associated with specific tooling and things like that. Informal is more associated with mentoring and just talking to somebody like over the shoulder kind of code review. Both can be very valuable. Formal is going to happen at like big companies and when you're working on big teams. Informal is going to happen everywhere, even in big companies and big teams. That's just kind of basic mentoring, which is a part of professional life. One thing that is very important if you're going to do a code review is preparation. you just go into a code review blind, it's gonna like the review is not gonna be very good. And so if you're somebody that's reviewing another person's code, you have to go over it ahead of time so that you can have a good discussion. All right, so those are the main points I wanted to talk about with regards to the code review. We went over a lot today. And so I'm going to go ahead and open it up to questions. But this is the official end of the lecture part of class. If you have questions, stick around and ask them. If you don't, see ya. Not next week, but the week after. Remember, next week is project week. And I'll be around on Slack and stuff next week for you to answer your questions. But we will not have lectures, but I will expect commits instead of lecture attendance. So have a great week next week. Ask me any questions right here that you haven't asked already in the chat. And all right. That's the end of class. Ask me questions. Otherwise, see you on Monday. So somebody is asking, is the app going to be due at the end of the semester, in December, or on the last day of class, which is November 24th? The app will be due towards the end of the semester, okay? We are trying to give y'all as much time as possible to work on this app, and as much time. Some people kind of felt like they got behind in the semester, and so we want to give some people more time to commit, and establish a good pattern of committing. So it will be due in December, into the semester, not the last day of class. However, there will of course be deliverables along the way, like the one that is next Friday. Great question. All right, well, it looks like y'all exhausted all of your comments and questions during class. Thanks for all the great questions and comments during class. Oh, somebody wants a link to this. Let me send that. All right, so I just put a link to Garrett Code Review right in the chat for you. Oh, somebody is not. Somebody says that Minty might be a little broken. I'm going to refresh that. I now have the. All right, for those of you that are not seeing the questions up on the screen, you may be on the last Minty. Make sure you have the right code 2241932. I just got another one though. Anyway, the Garrett code link is now in the chat. Yeah, there are questions probably of people using the other Minty code. I can check. Okay, here we go. Here's the other one. Can we code review with a more experienced programmer not in our group? Yeah, absolutely. That is not cheating. Code review from external people is awesome, and you should definitely do it. Please do it. That is awesome. Please do it. One of our methods is extremely long because it edits a bunch of text views. Is that okay? I mean, the answer, of course, is it really depends. I have a hard time imagining what is going on here, but a long method is not great. So you might want to break it down into like, hey, this edits this part of the text view, this edits this part of the text view, etc. But a long method is absolutely a code smell, could be a problem, could be hard to understand. Good questions though. I'm switching back here. Some people are using questions using the other Menti code. I'm just kind of going between the two now. All right, I'll give you another couple seconds and then I gotta get the heck out of here. So get those questions in if you have them. All right, it's been a lot of fun today. Thanks for your participation.